So I've actually had a lot of questions about this. What do you do? What do you, you know, what is your protocol? And so I'm going to be talking about it here for regenerative medicine. So it started in 2010, 2011, when I saw this slide by Gary Hitzig that showed this incredible result on one side with PRP and the other side, they look pretty bad. I think this is probably an overstatement that you would ever get anything of a good nature just from PRP. And in fact, I would tell you, you can't. But it still stimulated my thinking. So I started using Autogel, this system. I'd have no financial affiliations with any companies, had great results. Decided to finesse work by going over to the Angel system that gave me ability to titrate the volume and the concentration with the idea that maybe around this level was good. Then I heard a higher concentration was better. So I'm now currently using 5-7X. I don't think it really matters, to be honest with you. I've been getting the same results in all these different levels, but I think it's nice to be able to do a higher concentration. This beautiful slide I want you to memorize. No, this is from the company, and they told me that there's a certain reason for a certain percentage, and I got so blurred out from this slide, I guess I believe them. PPP, platelet poor plasma, may have similar efficacy. The slide from Tony Scalfani, who says that the efficacy range is actually quite similar. Do I use PPP? I do, and I'll tell you how. Again, no financial affiliations with any companies. Using Acell, which is basically that's the company's name. It's Acellular Matrix and Micromatrix. I use the fine powder form, 100 milligrams of that. Mix it with PRP. Unfortunately, I've been using it together the whole time, so I can't 100% tell you which one is doing which, but I've been using them since about 2011. So don't worry about taking a photo. I've sent you PDFs of all these talks. They are definitely going to be in your hands. So if you want to take a photo, you can, but you're going to have a copy of it. So basically with FUT, or linear strip excision surgery, I'm using about 14 cc's at 7% hematocrit. The reason of the higher hematocrit, it looks a little bloody, is that the argument by their scientific head is I'm actually drawing in more highly concentrated platelets. I don't know if that's true, but to me, the argument that you have to have no blood in there makes no sense because I'm injecting it into a bloody area. So, you know, people think I got to have a purely yellow color. Well, I don't buy that argument. And I basically use about 5 cc's of the platelet poor plasma after donor closure into that area. I use 15 cc's for my storage of my strip initially, just to keep it at a sort of a biologic bath, if you will. And then after I've made recipient sites, I'll show you how I've created a little bit of a tweak on this, of how I inject that into the recipient site bed after those are made, although I've done it before recipient sites with equally good results. So I cannot tell you that it really matters. And then I coat the grafts with PRP and Acell at the end before placement. Some people have asked, is it hard to place? My placers say no. They said there's no difference. So with FUE surgery, I'm doing a very similar concoction, except I'm not really using the platelet poor plasma, except just placing into the donor area at the end. I'm using a similar combination where I'm using the PRP into the recipient bed afterwards, and I'm using the PRP and Acell as to coat the grafts before insertion or placement. This is my modification. Essentially what it is I put this little shield around it so it doesn't spray in my eyes. It's a little, just a top of a little medicine bottle. And that way, I used to put like a towel down, whatever, and this way it's really elegant. I can inject and it doesn't spray up through the recipient sites. Without surgery, I have stopped using Acell. Actually, Sarah Wasbar has shown some evidence that it may decrease efficacy in standalone cases. I didn't see as much efficacy with it. I've now basically used pure PRP injections. I use about 15 to 30 cc's at 7% hematocrit, and I use about at a 3 to 5x concentration, about 30 cc's. It depends. I can use less, I can use higher concentration, and then I do a micropen to help really stimulate that. In the past, I would do single injections. I'm now doing more series where I'm doing one every about once a month, about four times in a row, and then every 6 months, I'm seeing much better results. How I do it, here's a step-by-step video. Because they're awake, I like to use Pronox. Sorry, I don't have any affiliation. I just shouldn't use any brand names, but breathable nitrous, portable breathable nitrous anesthesia gives them a little bit of relaxation. I like to put a little bit of lidocaine into little blebs. That way they don't feel as much into this area. And then I pass like some septicane or 4% articaine, septicane, that provides a deep anesthesia with less burn across this area to bridge those zones. And then I have the PRP. This is an older video where I had the A-cell, which I no longer use in this area. And then I inject it across the scalp. I divide it into sections so I have equal placement of it. I just place it into the subcutaneous plane. I don't think, you know, it's hard to get it intradermally, and I don't think there's a plane that has to be perfect in this. It's not as scientific as you think. Just spacing it across. I don't need the splash shield since there are no open recipient sites that would cause it to come back. I just massage it into area. And then I just basically use a microneedle type device at 2.5 millimeters to activate that area. And I try to get it to, I get a slight sunburn effect, which you're seeing here. So there are many ways to do this. You ask five doctors, you'll get five different ways of doing this. This is not the right way, it's just one way. And you need to activate it is important, whether you're using calcium gluconate, thrombin, or you're using physical activation like recipient sites or microneedle, you're getting some activation, which is important. What I've noticed in my hands when I'm doing this is I during that 2011 period, when I added it, I had some patients with moderately poor growth, and when I added it, I saw incredible growth differences. So they almost served as their own controls. A colleague of mine, Marcel Pichon, has done some studies where he's called it a personal growth index, meaning that if you go to the same surgeon, you may grow 80% every time. And if you grow 95%, you may grow 95% every time. I have now found a much more consistent growth since 2011 doing this combination of PRP and A-cell. The same thing, I saw not so good growth, and then I added it around 2011. I saw a much better take on the second surgery. Same thing here. These are just that really helped me transition over. Standalone PRP results can also give good results in terms of some nice hair growth for patients, and the maintenance is not so rigorous. I've been using liposomal ATP with hypothermosol since 2014. What I've noticed with that is finer growth, less, even if you have great placers, there's less trauma that you're seeing faster growth, finer growth, the growth looks better. Sometimes as early as four months I'm seeing growth, which I never saw before. I've also seen early on where most of the hairs can go into an angina and effluvium and fall out, but at 2 weeks, sometimes these hairs in a small percentage actually don't fall out at all. And that's pretty weird, but I've started seeing that with this combination, and with that combination, you can actually note why. I mean, those patients that don't fall out actually undergo a much faster growth. So my current protocol is using all four of these regenerative techniques to get results. My mix for this, again, you're going to get a PDF of this, is for a strip procedure. I'm basically taking about 50 cc's of that liposomal ATP, splitting it into 10, mixed with 100 cc's hypothermosol for sliver dissected grafts. For FUE, that's where my grafts are going as well. And then on the other side, I'm taking 40 cc's of ATP with 400 cc's of plasmolite, splitting that into a 300 cc mix to spray grafts, and a 100 cc mix that they're using for post-operative spray, that they spray every hour for the first few days. I tell patients that it's CPR for the grafts, and that way they understand the priority of how. Now, I've gotten great results before this, but I like to use that idea so that they go, I'm going to spray this. You know, this is not just junk. And I believe that that's important. I don't have them wake up middle of the night. I just have them do it every hour while they're awake if they can. And even if it takes them 5-7 days to drain it, I say just drain it until it's all gone. Stem cells using adipocytes, adipocytes. I do it for facial work. I do nanofat. I don't do it for hair. Some of the studies that I've looked at, I've been actually a reviewer for some of the journals that prior to the embargo, I mean, post-embargo, I can comment on it, is that it looks like the average length of duration of viability for stem cells of adipocytes is probably about 6 months. In my opinion, with 6 months of therapy with the donor morbidity that you get from harvesting, I don't see the efficacy. I actually had a And now if you go straight to stem cells, I think if you just purify it and you're not getting the actual physical fat cells, that's nice because you're not getting the bulking risk, you're not getting other risks. There was a patient I just saw that actually had necrosis of the scalp coming from another state due to fat injections into the scalp for hair loss, did not get any results except for hair loss and a necrosis. But I just don't think the long-term results are there in terms of viability. But everyone is different. People may really believe this is the way to go. I don't personally think it's a good long-term solution. So regenerative medicine is a huge part of my practice. I think it's very, very important to what I do in terms of surgery and also external to surgery. I've written about it in all the books here because I believe in it. And I really will leave you with this concept, which we're going to start with in the next lecture, which is vision. And I'm glad that you guys are here, and I hope this is the start point for a future in hair.